Well, all right. As I alluded to before halftime, it's about to get real spicy. In the words of Russell Wilson, okay? We have our quarterback rankings right now, numbers 15 through 11. And Zach, I guess, I know you're going to go first here to kick us off, but I guess we can recap the list. I'm going to recap mine, and then I'm going to send yours to recap, and then you could take it from there. I'm going to pull up my list right now. At number 32, I have Desmond Ridder. At number 31, I have Sam Howell. At number 30, I have C.J. Stroud. At number 29, I have Baker Mayfield. At number 28, I have Jordan Love. At number 27, I have Kenny Pickett. At number 26, I have Mac Jones. At number 25, I have Bryce Young. 24, AR-15. 23, Mr. Tannehill, Ryan Tannehill. At number 22, Jimmy G. At number 21, Kyler Murray. At number 20, I have Russell Wilson. Number 19, I have Brock Purdy. At number 18, I have Jared Goff. At number 17, I have Derek Carr. At number 16, I have Matthew Stafford. Zach, the mic is yours.
Yeah, so to recap mine before I get started with the next part of the list. At 32, I had Sam Howell. At 31, I had Jordan Love. 30, Ryan Tannehill. 29, C.J. Stroud. 28, Anthony Richardson. 27, Baker Mayfield. 26, Desmond Ridder. 25, Kyler Murray. 23, Mac Jones. Or sorry, 24, Mac Jones. 23, Bryce Young. Jimmy G from the Raiders at 22. Derek Carr at 21. Brock Purdy at 20, Deshaun Watson at 19, Kirk Cousins at 18, Matthew Stafford at, Matt Stafford at 18 or at 17, Russell Wilson at 16. I'll say that one more time. Sorry for those who got confused. Purdy at 20, Deshaun Watson at 19, Cousins at 18, Stafford at 17, Russell Wilson at 16. So without further ado, I will start off with number 15. On the list, and this is another guy, you know, Lil and I both said it multiple times last show, and I couldn't have said it more times. It's like ranking that 20 to 13, 14 part of the list, like that was the probably, I think Lil said this, like in the 2+ years that we've been doing this list, like of any time we've ever done the list, this right here is probably the most difficult portion of the list to do, and I'm still struggling. I'm still going back and forth. Lil, I don't know if you had anything to say about that, but feel free to chip in if you do.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it was very hard. You know, I was changing it up to last night, and I think I found a happy medium to roll out mine's after yours.
Gotcha. So yeah, without further ado, let's get into it all. Number 15. This is a guy that was very difficult for me to find the right place on the list for him, is because if you were to just base this on everything he did last year, he'd be much higher. And even if you look at his overall resume, like he's had some really good moments. He's led a team to a Super Bowl. But the issue is, at his previous destination, it felt like every time he had a really good year, the next year he would just regress. And he could never just get to that consistent level of really good play. And I'm talking about Jared Goff of the Detroit Lions coming in at number 15 on my list. And Goff was really good last year, right? The Lions were one of the best offenses in the league, especially by season's end. And I do think it was very important for them to bring back their offensive coordinator, Ben Johnson. I think Goff having that continuity is so key. Like the thing that makes Goff so interesting to me is he's one of those guys, and I know most guys are like this, but for him in particular, it feels extreme. Like if he has a really good offensive line with good weapons and good coaching, he looks like one of the 10 best quarterbacks in the league, maybe even better. He showed us he's capable of getting a team to a Super Bowl. But as soon as you take away a little bit of that, he could just go way downhill the other direction. And that's why Goff is so hard to rank. That's why I don't think Detroit has really committed to him yet as their full-time franchise quarterback of the future. But I do think Goff is going to be better. He's older. He's more mature. He's with Ben Johnson. He still has the best offensive line in the league, in my opinion, playing in front of him, either Detroit or Philly. It's really neck and neck for the best offensive line in the league. Still has plenty of weapons. You know, hopefully Jameson Williams will be back ready to go after that suspension. But Amon-Ra St. Brown, they have two new running backs they bring in. There are plenty of weapons in Detroit. I think the Lions offense should still be pretty good. It's going to come down to their defense and if they could get enough stops if they want to win games. So I'll have Jared Goff at number 15. At number 14, I'm going to go with my guy here. I know this name has come up in terms of, you know, when am I going to have this guy ranked? But I'm going to go with Kenny Pickett of the Steelers at number 14. And this is high. I get it. But I will refresh everyone who's listening in their memory. When we did this list last year, right, I took a little bit of a risk. I had Jalen Hurts of the Eagles at number 16. And that I understand, especially knowing like what he is now.
You sure it wasn't 15?
Or it might have been 15, honestly.
Yeah, I think it was 15.
15, okay, yeah. So I had him at 15. You know, I took a little bit of a risk having him there. And the reason why I had that is because when we do this list, we know everyone has their own criteria, but I like to project a little bit, especially when it comes to the younger quarterbacks and guys we don't really have a ton of evidence on. But the reason why I had Hurts there was because I thought he was going to be the young quarterback that takes that next step forward, that takes that leap and just immediately gets better. And we saw Hurts do that and then some, of course, leading the Eagles to the Super Bowl. I'm not saying that Kenny Pickett, when we're doing this list next year, I'm not saying he's going to be a top five quarterback. He might be, but I'm not saying he is. But I think Pickett is going to be the young quarterback that really takes a step forward this year. And I mentioned this when Will brought up Pickett on his list, but I wanted to reemphasize this, right? The Pittsburgh Steelers started last season terribly. They were a bad football team. They were 2-6 to start the season. They lost to the Eagles 35-13 in a game that wasn't even competitive in week 8. And they were awful. They were 2-6, and it was looking like Mike Tomlin was finally going to have his first losing season, and we could finally stop with every time you want to make up an excuse for Tomlin. Oh, he's never had a losing season. You know, we all thought that was going to be over. But then all of a sudden, they finally make a quarterback change, and Kenny Pickett ended the season with a 7-2 record after the Steelers had their bye in week 9. And everything I know about this kid is that he's a great leader. His teammates already love him. His teammates already respect him. And I think the overall football part of his game, it's going to get better within time. I understand he was drafted when he was a little bit older, but we've seen some older quarterbacks like Joe Burrow really get into the NFL a little bit later compared to some of their counterparts and use that experience and their age to their advantage and really get going. I do think Kenny Pickett is going to be the young quarterback that takes that step forward this year. He has plenty of weapons playing, of course, with Deontay Johnson and the connection he had with George Pickens. I thought the chemistry they had throughout last season was noticeable. It was really impressive. And you know how I feel, man. Like, if I was the Steelers, I would have started Pickett week 1 last year. And if they would have done that instead of Mitch Trubisky, I think they would have made the playoffs last year. And the fact that the Steelers were even alive for a playoff spot entering the last week of the season when they were 2-6 and they were looking like one of the worst teams in the league last year at one point, that's really impressive stuff. I think it all starts with the quarterback. I think Pickett is going to be the young quarterback that takes the leap forward this season. I will have him at number 14. At number 13, I'm going to go with another young quarterback that I think will take a significant step forward this season. But it's interesting because I think this guy's super boom or bust. You know, Will, I think you already know who I'm talking about. But
Justin Fields.
Exactly. The young quarterback in Chicago, Justin Fields, coming in at number 13. And the thing for me, right, is with Fields. He was on an awful team last year that I'm not even sure they were trying to win games. So I'm not going to blame any of the Chicago Bears having the worst record of the league. You know, Fields was honestly part of the reason why they were even competitive in some games. If they didn't have him, there were plenty of games they would have just gotten blown out in, and at least they were an entertaining watch. But my thing with Fields is, like, when you watch him, and you just watch his highlight tape, there is no doubt this guy is a dynamic, electric player who has the potential to be one of the best quarterbacks in the league one day. But my question is, can he actually win games? Does he have the qualities to really take a team like the Bears, who, you know, they have better talent now, and now that he has D.J. Moore and a couple other really good weapons around him, we're going to learn, okay, is this guy really the real deal? There's a chance he's not. You know, we have no evidence that he has that clutch gene, that he's really going to be the guy going forward. But when we watch him, there's no doubt the Bears haven't had a talent at quarterback like this ever. They're the only team in the history of the NFL right now. They've never had a quarterback throw for over 4,000 yards in a season. Now, I understand passing might not necessarily be Fields' strong suit right now, but I think he will get better at that. I actually thought Matt Eberflus, considering circumstances, didn't do a terrible job last year. Like, I remember when the Bears first hired him, I thought, man, there's a chance this hire could go down as one of the worst in this cycle. I'm actually feeling a little bit indifferent on him right now. I think he could be a good coach. You know, the jury's still out on him. The jury's still out on Fields, in my opinion. But you can't deny the natural talent of Fields. I think he'll be better, and the Bears will win more games with more talent around him. And one other thing I'll say, you know, we're just looking at these quarterback rankings right now, and Will, I believe yours is the same way. Like, we both agree, Justin Fields is the best quarterback in the NFC North, like, right now. Aaron Rodgers, he's out of the division. We both, according to our list, agree. He's better than Goff. He's better than Kirk Cousins. He's better than Jordan Love. And usually when you have a team like that, that has the best quarterback in their division with some talent around them, I usually like to pick those teams to do pretty well. I think the Bears could be a sleeper team in the NFC this upcoming season. And Fields is a big reason why. I'll have him at number 13. At number 12, this is an interesting one because when this guy's on the field, kind of like Goff in a way, when he's at his best, looks like a top 10 quarterback. But there's still some concerns. There's still some risks. Injuries have a lot to do with it. I'm going to go with Tua Tagovailoa coming in at number 12 on the list from the Dolphins. And I was impressed with Tua last year, right? He finally gets a real head coach in Mike McDaniel. He finally gets that big-time elite wide receiver in Tyreek Hill, and he takes off. You know, when Tua was healthy, there weren't many offenses better than the Miami Dolphins last year. And I do think Miami, they are a contender in the AFC East to win the division. They were a playoff team last year. And Mike McDaniel, it's hard not to be really impressed with him. I think, like his guy, Kyle Shanahan, he does a great job of really making the games easier for his quarterbacks and putting them in a position to succeed. And I don't know how everyone listening is going to take this, but when I watch Tua, I do see a little bit of what we saw from Jimmy Garoppolo when he was in San Francisco, you know, just making the game easier for your weapons. You know, your head coach puts you in a good position to succeed, and the Dolphins have won games with Tua. Hopefully he's able to stay on the field and healthy. The concussions, those are obviously a huge concern after everything that happened last year, but I'm a Tua believer. I think this Dolphin team and this Dolphins offense should be pretty good. I'll have him at number 12. At number 11, and it's crazy because this guy, talk about Tua needing a coach and needing some weapons. I would put this guy in the same category because this past season was really the first time we saw him with a legit weapon, with a legit coach, and he took off. That's Daniel Jones of the New York Giants. I'll have him coming in at number 11, and it was hard not to be really impressed with what Daniel Jones did last year, putting together the best regular season by a Giant quarterback in a pretty long time. Brian Daboll, he did a great job getting the Giants to the playoffs. They beat the Vikings in a pretty epic playoff game that Jones, I thought more than Barkley, really won that game for the Giants. Jones got rewarded. He got the big contract. Now, when it comes to Jones, I was debating putting him in the top 10, but my thing is with him, I still don't know if you could win a Super Bowl with Daniel Jones as your quarterback or even get to one. I want to see improvements from Daniel Jones this season that makes me say, okay, instead of being a surprise playoff team that no one sees coming and has some good playoff wins, you know, the Giants had a great win over the Vikings in the playoffs last year, but as soon as the Giants got to Philadelphia for that game against the Eagles Saturday night in the playoffs, that game was over at kickoff. The Eagles scored a touchdown on their first drive, and they never looked back. Could Daniel Jones take, again, even another step forward, like Josh Allen kind of did in his second year under Brian Daboll, and really raise his ceiling to be, you know what, I'm good enough to take this Giants team to the next level. They're paying me all this money. I'm going to show them they made the right decision. I think he's capable of doing that, but I'm not convinced he's going to be able to do it just yet. I just need to see it. So I'll have Daniel Jones coming in at number 11. To recap my portion of the list, I'll have Jared Goff at number 15, Kenny Pickett at number 14, Justin Fields at number 13, Tua Tagovailoa at number 12, and Daniel Jones at number 11. Lil, I'll throw the mic your way.
Yeah, definitely. I would like to respond to, you know, just a few things there. I have a response, and then I have a take question followed up after that one response. I'm going to respond to two things and ask a question at the end. Now, when you talked about Tua Tagovailoa, right, and we're going to find out if he's on this set of lists or the next week set of lists. We're going to find that out. I'm not going to spoil that. I think when you talked about him and comparing him to Jimmy Garoppolo, right, I think I can see where you're coming from, right? You know, the ecosystem, the same offense, essentially, the Kyle Shanahan offense, right, where there's a lot of playmakers, and the offense generally runs through the playmakers and stuff like that. They predicate on winning the football, but there's a difference. McDaniels actually passed the ball a lot more, right? And there's a different trust that McDaniels have in Tua that Kyle Shanahan does not have in Jimmy G. Like, they threw the ball a lot with Tua. So McDaniels had that trust in Tua where if you look at Kyle Shanahan, it's like, nah, I don't trust you like that. We don't see that same trust. Another thing, too, is that Tua actually hit the deep ball, something that Jimmy G doesn't bring you that upside, which is making those shots down the field. So, yes, I see the comparison, but I do think there's some differences there. And I can let you respond to that before I come with the next, if you want to.
No, I agree. I do think that's part of what was so noticeable about Tua in his first year with McDaniel is Coach McDaniel really let him rip the ball. You know,
let him rip it. Yeah,
it was the opposite of Brian Flores, and I do think that helped Miami win a lot of games. And it's interesting too, man, because I think back to that playoff game against the Bills, and I know Miami ended up losing that game, but McDaniel might just be the real deal as a coach, man. Like, they were in that game the whole way with Skylar Thompson at quarterback, going up against the team that everyone declared as the Super Bowl favorites entering the season. Miami was this close to beating Buffalo in the first round of the playoffs. And then 2 weeks prior, they played also on a Saturday night in Buffalo. Miami was very competitive in that game with Tua. So health is the key, in my opinion. But when he's on the field, I think he's a really good QB.
Now, the next thing I want to respond to, we know what's coming, is the Kenny Pickett, you know, situation. And it's funny because, you know, I'm going to have a take question here. Obviously, I know you're tired of hearing the comparison that I'm making with him and Teddy Bridgewater. And it's not really out of disrespect. I already hinted at the comparisons. Specifically, I'm talking about the 2015 Teddy Bridgewater for anybody wondering, like, what is this guy talking about? I'm talking about 2015 Minnesota Vikings, you know, Teddy Bridgewater. And it's funny because when you watch Teddy Bridgewater that year, I considered him to be a gamer. And I could consider Kenny Pickett in that way, a gamer. Doesn't have the best physical attributes, but he's a gamer when he's on the football field. I considered Teddy Bridgewater to be that in 2015. And it's funny because both in the ACC, Louisville, Pittsburgh, I remember in Louisville, his last year, Teddy Bridgewater, I'm talking about senior year, they won a bowl game, a BCS bowl. In particular, they beat Florida, actually steamrolled Florida in the Sugar Bowl, right? And we think about Kenny Pickett, I believe they made a BCS Bowl with Pittsburgh, if I'm not mistaken. Zach, if you want to look that up real quickly. Well,
unfortunately, you know, this is just a result of the era we live in today's world of college football. But Pickett, I don't think he played in their bowl game. They played Michigan State, and he just sat out. But they did win the ACC championship against Wake Forest, so he had
his he was in the Heisman. So yeah. The Heisman.
I was just going to look that up. Do you know off the top of your head if Bridgewater finished top three in the Heisman? He might have. I don't know.
I don't think so. But I know they made the BCS, but you could correct me if I'm wrong on that. But I don't think he was a top three finalist for a Heisman.
Yeah.
But
go ahead. Continue.
Yeah, basically the translation with my comparison is that they both led mid ACC teams to high profile pastures in their last years on the team. And you know, yeah, and the comparisons on the football field. But needless to say, the take question that I had is that when you look at the Steelers, clearly their system and philosophy this year is going to be rushing the rock with Najee Harris, Jaylen Warren, and that's pretty much going to box Kenny Pickett into that game manager role, right? They're going to box him into that. You know, generally when you rush the rock a lot and you sprinkle the pass, you're looked upon as a game manager, right? The same Ryan Tannehill effect, the same, Jimmy G effect, right? And we know that's really not sustainable for long-term success, just rushing the rock first and being primarily a rushing team, as we saw with the Titans when they was rushing with Derrick Henry. By the time they got to the playoffs, you know, it was the day in the headlights. They didn't know how to pass the rock consistently. Same thing with the Ravens. Lamar Jackson, run, 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 run. And when it's time to pass, you want to run, run, run. And you can't win in the playoffs that way. It could win regular season games, right? Rushing the rock first, you can win regular season games. But playoffs, not sustainable. My question is, do you think you're higher on Kenny Pickett more so than the Steelers are, based on how we know they're going to rush the rock and construct their offense around Pickett instead of letting Pickett let it fly? Do you think you have more faith than the own organization of Kenny Pickett and the fans as well?
I think that's a really good question. And the answer might be yes. You might be onto something, because the thing that I keep on looking back to is there were two games in particular last year, right? Where the Steelers and Matt Canada, look, we all know how we both feel about him. Like, he has no business being an NFL offensive coordinator, even in college, he wasn't very good. As a matter of fact, he recruited the best move he ever made, maybe in football in his life, was recruiting Kenny Pickett to come to the University of Pittsburgh. So they've known each other a while. They've had that connection. But I don't agree with the run first philosophy. And it's interesting. Like, I think that might even just come down from, like, I'm not saying the owner's telling, like, the offensive coordinator what to do, but, you know, the Steelers, you know, they've had so many great running backs, Franco Harris, over the course of their franchise's history. They drafted Najee Harris in the first round. I think they really want to make sure that pick and that investment is worth it. But part of me thinks Pickett is just Canada-proof, because there were two games earlier or last year that throughout the game, throughout the first 3.5 quarters of the game, the Steelers offense, they couldn't really get anything going. And the game I'm talking about was a Sunday night game. They were both primetime games, actually. One of them was against the Ravens on Sunday Night Football. The Steelers in that game, they're down 13 to 10 for the majority of the game, basically with 3 minutes left. And in his last time touching the ball, Pickett leaves a 60-yard comeback drive. Then a couple weeks later against the Raiders, also a primetime game Saturday night, the Steelers offense, they can't do anything the whole night. But then it's almost like Tom Brady in Tampa Bay last year. I'm not trying to compare Kenny Pickett and Tom Brady, but you remember there were plenty of games when the Buccaneers, they would just run the ball. And it was clear, like, it was not working. But then as soon as they need Brady to throw the ball and make plays at the end, he's doing it and leading game-winning drives. That's kind of what happened in Pittsburgh last year, when they could just never get the passing game going until they really had to. And when they relied on Pickett to use his arm and make big plays and make clutch plays, he was able to do that. So I'm hoping as the season goes on, they rely on Pickett more.
Okay. Zach, I'm ready to go forward. I don't have no more questions and comments right now. 15 to 11. And I'm going to start us off in Minnesota. I'm going to go with Captain Kirk, right? Kirk Cousins at number 15. Stat man. Yes, I agree. He's a stat man, you know, and he has the best wide receiver in the league. That's why he's up here this far. In Justin Jefferson. So he has the connection for the protection. Okay. He has the best wide receiver in the league. He's going to make him look good. He should be a top 15 quarterback this year. And matter of fact, when you take in consideration Kevin O'Connell, second year in the offense, I don't expect a drop off. I expect a familiarity there. TJ Hockenson, when he got traded, the first couple games was very quiet, like a library, as far as his production. But in that playoff game, TJ Hockenson put up some gaudy numbers. So I expect a very same, similar version, but a little bit better and more continuity that doesn't result in 12, I believe, interceptions that Kirk Cousins threw last year. I think they're going to be better. You know, say what you want. I understand they traded, not traded, but they released Dalvin Cook. So a lot of people is going to have questions about if the offense could sustain. I still think Kirk Cousins, he can air it out. You know, I think a lot of people underrate his arm strength. A lot of people consider him not having a strong arm. I don't agree with that. He's not Justin Herbert. He's not Patrick Mahomes. He's not Josh Allen. He doesn't throw the ball as deep as they do, but he can make the throws. I've seen it. You know, I've seen him make the throws down the field. And I can literally bank on him throwing for 4,000 yards a year. And yes, Stat Man. Yes, I get it. But Stat Man is going to be a top 15 quarterback this year. And Kirk Cousins, we know he's not going to show up in prime time. We know the usual. The James Harden effect, right? Same thing. You know, the twins that never met before. But listen, there was one game in particular that Cousins made. And I think he's a great teammate. A lot of this too, believe it or not, and I know I'm going off the deep end here, but I'm not really. And truly, a lot of this matters to me. Like, do your teammates gravitate towards you as a quarterback? I think that's an unsung thing that I've used in this ranking. Right? I understand I'm projecting you into the air. That's the main thing here. I'm looking at the eye test as well. I'm looking at your situation. But do your teammates like you? When you see Kirk Cousins on an airplane with chains on, just vibing with his teammates, you know, vibing, that matters to me. If your teammates vouch for you like Justin Jefferson does with Kirk Cousins, that matters to me. And that's another reason why he's up here this high. And you know, I just wish I had more of that one playoff game that I got from Kirk Cousins when he made that throw to Kyle Rudolph, if I'm not mistaken, or Thielen, one of those guys. It was Thielen or I wrote it down.
It was Rudolph.
It was Rudolph. Yeah. It was like a 43-yard bomb. And it's funny because I watched that highlight recently and Dylan did not create, or Rudolph did not create a lot of separation there. That throw was perfect. That throw was literally where it had to be. And they won that game against the Saints. And he threw up a lob in the corner to cap it off. That was the best game I ever seen from Kirk Cousins because of the moment and the throws that he made in the clutch in the moment. There's some talent here. I understand we joke about him in prime time, but there is some talent here. And that's why he's number 15. At number 14, I'm going to go with another stat man, Dak Prescott. Led the NFL in interceptions 15 last year, despite missing five games. He's the most overrated quarterback in football. He's not a playoff performer. 2-4 to be exact in the playoffs. The Dallas Cowboys, arguably, for the last couple years, had the best roster in the NFC. No avail. And I want to reflect back to that playoff game last year against the 49ers, divisional round. Oh, man. The Cowboys' defense was struggling prior to that game, and I wasn't expecting a lot. I was expecting a blowout, kind of. And their defense showed up in that game. They stuffed CMC behind the line of scrimmage. They stuffed Deebo Samuel. They literally did a good job of putting those weapons that the 49ers have at the disposal in check. And that game was up for taking, for the taking. And in the fourth quarter, a game-tying drive with a couple minutes left, Dak Prescott had the opportunity in front of the world to show his stripes and defeat narratives. I always say a lot of people hate when we throw narratives and box people. We always have those narrative savers out here. Oh, you know, that's unfair. You know, he does this. I don't care. He had his opportunity to defeat a narrative and lead a game-tying drive in the fourth quarter. And Michael Gallup was streaming open, and he threw the ball literally where he had to stop and try to turn his body to get that catch, and he couldn't. That was a throw that I'm going to remember when we talk about Dak Prescott, the one that he didn't complete and the interceptions he threw. Now, yeah, sure, he could throw 4,000 yards this year. They added Brandon Cooks. Cool. 34 touchdowns. Cool. I get it. But can he carry a team to a Super Bowl is my question. Can he? No, he can't. And that's my answer. You know, and that's why I'm going to leave him at number 14. And I'm not thinking about putting him higher. I never thought about it. He's at number 14. Now, 13. This is where things are going to get very interesting for me. Because, Zach, when we did the show last week, right, and we had our rankings, number 20 through 16, I went first. And I think I actually shifted your mind on one of those rankings, because you told me that you changed your list as I was speaking. I'm not sure who it was, but if you want to let me know who it was, by all means. If it was, did I change your mind? Was it Matthew Stafford?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I think it was the spot, but I switched, I think, Stafford and Russ. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I think I influenced your mind on Stafford. The reason why I brought that up is because when you were speaking and you went first, you shifted my mind on these two guys. At number 13, I'm going to go with Justin Fields. Right? I'm going to explain to you why I made the switch from number 12, and I'm going to tell you who's at number 12 when I get there. Number 13, I'm going with Justin Fields. And I'm banking on a breakout. You know, a lot of my list is what I perceive you to be at the end of the year. I'm going to project you into the year. I need some insurance, though. I wanted to go higher. I even thought about going top 10. But I said to myself, Jaleel, you're going to have to, I refer to myself as Real Lil when I'm talking sports. So Lil, Real Lil, you're going to have to take some insurance here. You can't really go that far, right? And you referenced where you had Jalen Hurts last year, number 15. Nobody thought he was a top 15 quarterback when you had him ranked. And look where we are now. He's not mentioned. A lot of people think he's top five, arguably. Maybe the best, right? Some people may say that. And that's the risk that we take, and that's what generates the happiness to do these lists year in and year out. It's projecting those breakouts, right? Projecting those declines. That's why I love doing what I do. And I'm going to put my reputation on the line. I'm going to go Justin Fields at 13. I think adding that wide receiver and D.J. Moore is going to give the vibes of Chris Olave and Justin Fields from Ohio State. We saw when you have a good wide receiver playing with Justin Fields, what can happen. Justin Fields, he loves his receivers to be there. He doesn't like you know, waiting for you to create that separation. There was no guy here that could create that separation that Justin Fields needed. So he held the ball. We know that he has the skill sets to succeed. We know he has the explosion. But can he take that next leap as a passer? You have to supply him with the weapons first before we can even assume if he can or cannot. Okay? In college, I know what I saw. My eyes didn't fail me. He was one of the more accurate throwers of the football in college. I still think he can throw the deep ball and be accurate in the league. We just need to see him with the right roster. And I think Ryan Poles is building that right roster. Listen, another reason why I have him this high is because the Bears had the opportunity to move off of Justin Fields. They had the number one overall pick. They could have got that guy in, you know, Bryce Young and traded Justin Fields for more assets, as much as what they got, but they stuck to Justin Fields. Two times they stuck with Justin Fields. That time and another time when they drafted him, right? They stuck by his side. They believe in him. What you said?
Traded up to get him.
And they traded up to get him. They stuck with him during the offseason when they had the number one overall, thus creating me to stick with Justin Fields. There's something there. The Bears believe it, and I care to believe it, too. So I'm going to go with Justin Fields at number 13. I believe we are going to get an MVP-type season from him. And, you know, I don't like to do the comparing game. We saw it with Jalen Hurts. We saw it with Lamar Jackson. I think the Bears are going to build their roster to fit that Lamar Jackson type of scheme to break out. And I'm going to have him at 13. I'm going to keep my insurance policy there and not move him any higher. At number 12, I'm going to go with Daniel Jones. I'm going to explain the change. When you started speaking and you referenced Justin Fields, right? You said something very important. He is make or break. So with all the good stuff that I had to say about Justin Fields, there is a reality that set in when you talk about it's really a make or break, a boom or bust to be exact, right? Boom or bust. So I had to really think about it from that perspective. You're right, Zach. And when you talked about, you know, Daniel Jones, you said some good stuff. You know, can he take that Josh Allen year three leap? That really swayed me to move him over, you know, Justin Fields. And that's why I'm going to go with him at number 12. Look, there's one comparison I want to make, right? And it's not really a, you know, comparison more so than it is a difference. When you talk about Dak Prescott, right, who I had earlier on my list, number 14 to be exact, you look at his interceptions. The turnovers the last couple years, I mean, he threw 15 last year. He threw 10 from, I believe he threw 10 a couple years ago. He had 14 fumbles lost from the 2017-2019 area. Jones started 37 games, committed 49 turnovers in the first couple years. But in 2023, he actually turned the ball over only 8 times. So you can kind of see the trajectory here. You can see Daniel Jones protecting the football more, and you can see Dak Prescott turning the ball over more. And that's why it was clear that I was going to rank Daniel Jones higher than Dak Prescott. And I think it's very important to acknowledge that. His dual threat abilities give him more upside than a lot of the guys that I have at the bottom of him. You know, I think you have to factor in that dual threat ability. I understand we give a lot of the praise to Brian Daboll, who's able to master our offense to fit a quarterback's strengths. But we have to realize the quarterback has to have something to work with. And his ability to be mobile and be a dual threat quarterback, Ryan Daboll was able to have something to work with along with Saquon Barkley and what he brought to the table. And I always say this, take Jared Goff, take Derek Carr, take Dak Prescott, take Kirk Cousins, take all those guys, Jimmy G, and put these quarterbacks in the same roster that the Giants had last year. They're not making the playoffs. Better yet, winning a playoff game. Okay, they're not, respectfully. They're game managers. Daniel Jones is not a game manager. For those of y'all that need to drink the coffee and smell the coffee and wake the hell up, he's not a game manager. He's a very good quarterback. Yes, we don't have to call him elite yet, but he's a very good quarterback. And I think that this year, they should be able to throw the ball down the field a little bit more. That's one of the things that I want to see with the Giants this year, is their ability to push the ball down the field with those explosive plays. I know Daniel Jones can make those throws. I've seen him do it against the Saints. I've seen him do it against the Chiefs in prime time. But you need the roster and the weapons to do so. And I think they added some pieces. Darren Waller, the tight end. You know, Paris Campbell, the speed. Jalen Hyatt from Tennessee. We got to see if he could translate to the NFL. There's a lot of questions with him from the media. But those are upgrades from what he had last year. He got paid. He got his money. Now he needs to show the league and the fans and the naysayers why he's worth the money. I'm going with Daniel Jones at number 12. At number 11, this is going to be very, very controversial. I know I'm going to get a response from Zach here when we done, when we wrap this up. I'm going to go with Aaron Rodgers at number 11. And I feel confident that this is where I'm going to rank him. I thought about pushing him in the top 10 just for the sake of media gratification. But I have to realize that I am the real Lil. I love the smoke. I love the beating. I don't need the media gratification here. I'm going to rank him where I think he's going to be ranked at the end of next year. I'm going to go with him at number 11. I am not buying the Jets hype, with all due respect. I'm not. I think we could see a similar Brett Favre situation where, you know, he goes to the Jets, throws 22 interceptions. Now, I don't think Aaron Rodgers is going to throw 22 interceptions. He's not that gunslinger that Brett Favre was. In fact, I think Aaron Rodgers, although able to make the throws down the field, I still think he has that. He's gun-shy sometimes to his fault, because he doesn't want to create turnovers. He's a guy that loves to be turnover-free. So sometimes he leaves a lot of meat on the bone, right? And I understand that the Jets, you know, a lot of people thought they was one quarterback away. The league doesn't work like that, right? We can't just look at the Jets like they're this Hollywood star of a movie where it's all about them and how close they were to taking that leap. We got to look at the league, and the league has something to do with it. The AFC East, yeah, everybody thought they was a player away. The Dolphins did it as well, right? They thought there was one concussion from not happening away from making the playoffs last year. The Bills still think they're right there at the cusp, right? Bill Belichick, you know? Yes, I'm going to just leave it. Bill Belichick, I'm not going to say nothing about them. But it, Bill Belichick, I'm just leaving it like that. So the AFC East is competitive. There's no guarantees here. You know, I'm going to have four quarterbacks. Well, not four, because Mac Jones is later. But I'm going to have three quarterbacks in the AFC East in my top 10. They all going to have a great year. I don't know about all that. And another thing, too. You know, last year, I didn't think he showed me anything last year. And a lot of people blamed it on the injury. A lot of people blamed it on the weapons and the lack of cohesiveness with the group. The lack of continuity is the word I'm looking for. But I tell you this, Zach. He's 39 years old, right? And I understand that a lot of people say age ain't nothing but a number, right? But it is. It matters. There's not a lot of guys 40 and up, because Rodgers will be 40 at the end of the year, that have had success in the NFL. Tom Brady is not a trend, folks. He's not a trend. He's an outlier. He's the greatest quarterback of all time. So a lot of people think with the advances in modern medicine with Tom Brady, oh, he's playing into his 45, 46 years old. He's having success. It's going to be the new norm. No, it's not. It's still a violent game. It's not. He's an outlier. When you look at quarterbacks, I'm going to mention these quarterbacks here. Peyton Manning was shot at the age of 39. His defense carried him into a Super Bowl. He retired after the age of 39. Eli Manning retired at the age of 39. Big Ben retired after the age of 39. Rivers retired after the age of 39. Looked shot. Didn't look good in that wild card game against Buffalo. Quarterbacks decline. And one thing that I liked about Aaron Rodgers in the past, and I'm not sure if he's going to have that same pop, is his athletic ability to be able to roll out and make some of the scramble throws down the football field. I think he's going to be really a pocket passer, and I still think he can make some of the throws, but I don't think he's going to be that same Rodgers. So I am expecting a decline. I like my 10 guys that I have ahead of him. And one more thing, too. A lot of people had a bone to pick with me because I ranked Aaron Rodgers 6th last year, right? And guess what? I was being too generous. He wasn't the top 6 quarterback last year. So I'm pretty sure I'm going to get the responses about having him 11. And I welcome it. I'm going to have him at number 11. So to recap my list, at number 15, I'm going to go Kirk Cousins. At number 14, I'm going to go Dak Prescott. At number 13, I'm going to go with Justin Fields. At number 12, I'm going to go with Daniel Jones. And at number 11, I'm going to go with Aaron Rodgers. Zach, the mic is yours.
Yeah, well, so just because you just mentioned it, it's fresh off the mind. I'll get into Rodgers. So you make a valid point with all the guys like Eli Manning, Peyton Manning, Philip Rivers, like all the guys you just mentioned that hit age 39, age 40, and then immediately it was clear. Like, we saw the decline. They don't have a ton of good football left. Where we'll disagree is I think, yes, Aaron Rodgers was not very good last year, especially for what our expectations were for the Packers. But I think that was a lot due to the fact, and this is on Rodgers, by the way, like, this was his fault, was he didn't come engaged enough. He didn't, after the Packers lost Devontae Adams, he should have made it a priority to come to training camp, to come to OTAs, to really gain that chemistry with Christian Watson, with Romeo Doubs, like all those new young receivers they had. And that's something I put on Rodgers. Now, the thing that makes it interesting is Rodgers was in Green Bay for such a long time, and now he's coming to a new team that hopefully with the Jets is ready to win. And I think hopefully in best case scenario, Rodgers come, you know, we saw him show up to training camp, to OTAs with the Jets. That's something he was not doing with Green Bay, even after he got paid. So I'm hoping that this re-energizes him a little bit. And my other thing is this, I just mentioned it too. Like, when we watched the end of Peyton Manning, it was clear he was washed. He was done. We all agreed he made the right decision retiring. Same with Philip Rivers in that playoff game against Buffalo. Same thing with Eli Manning. I wouldn't put Aaron Rodgers into that category just yet. I still think he has 2 to 3 really good seasons of football left. And I do think, you know, I'm not excusing him totally, but I think the injury had a little bit to do with it. I think that, you know, him not showing up to training camp last year or to minicamp had a little bit to do with it. But I do think that at times last year when we watched Rodgers, there were moments that made us realize, like, or at least made me realize, like, okay, this guy, he still has it. He could still make some of those big time, tough, top notch throws he was able to make throughout his whole career in Green Bay. He did that at times last year. Now, and what I'm banking on is that with a new team, in a new situation, he's re-energized and he's able to continue the version of himself, hopefully close to it, that we saw when he was winning MVPs in 2020 and 2021. And the last time, I will say, I'll end on this, the last time he was motivated and the last time that he was in a little bit of a similar situation when his future with Green Bay was a little bit unknown, after they drafted Jordan Love, we saw the best version of Aaron Rodgers we've seen recently with those back-to-back MVPs. So where we'll disagree is I'm not putting him in that conversation with Eli, with Peyton, with Rivers just yet, because when I watched those guys towards the back end of their career, it was clear to me, like, man, these guys are washed. They're cooked. It's time for them to retire. I didn't put Aaron Rodgers into that category. Obviously, I haven't named him on my list just yet, so I'll have more to say when we get to him. But, I'll leave it at that.
Yeah, I would like to respond to it. You see, you started off your take with exactly some of the things that I took in consideration and why I ranked him lower than where you had him. You talked about the fact that he was disengaged. You talked about the fact that he didn't show up to training camp, so it did tamper with the continuity that he could have generated with those young receivers, you know, the calling them out in front of the press conference. Those are the qualities that I briefly alluded to. That's the unsung hero of where I'm ranking you, leadership. And Zay could come on this show, and because he always, anytime Rodgers say something good since he joined the Jets, oh yeah, that's why he's a good leader. Always trying to defend that guy's leadership. I know what I hear, I know what I see, and I'm going to take with what I hear and what I see in consideration. And the PR is not going to sway me. Right? You could talk a good game. Listen, I'm hearing these politics lie every single day. These government officials, right? The daggone president lying. I know how to spot a fraud when I see one. Okay? And that's one of the things that I'm really good at, is detecting a fraud. My metal detectors go up. So leadership matters. And when you look at Rodgers, he's not, I understand his teammates, and you could flip that and say his teammates say, when have we seen a lot of teammates really come at players, right? Individuals. They don't, right? Players, they generally support the guy who's on their team today, and they don't really say nothing bad or throw them under the bus. But Rodgers, we've seen him throw people under the bus. We've seen him miss out on valuable continuity reps last year that affected his play. I'm not going to overlook that part of the equation. I need to see better leadership. And another thing, too, I understand he won playoff games in the past, but he hasn't won a chip since 2010. And I understand that's cliche, right? Oh, we're going to hear this over and over again, but it's real, right? The NFC North, he had a stranglehold, excuse me, over the division. He owned the Bears, according to him. That was his best opportunity to win a chip. When you look at the AFC East, and a lot of this, you know, that came in consideration here, is that if you really want to know today, if I had to give a prediction, obviously we're going to do these later, I think the Jets are the third or fourth team in the AFC East. Right now, maybe third, because I'm not sure what New England is going to do as far as advancements to the roster. But right now, maybe three or four. And realistically, if I think you're going to be three or four, how do you fit in the top 10? Unless we have three or four great quarterbacks that's going to light it up and they're just going to lose because of defense. Like, nah, I think the AFC East is more of the race to 30. And the AFC North is the race to keep you under 20. So a lot of these things are going to be stat padding for sure. I get it. But I just can't rank three quarterbacks in my top 10 when I'm trying to figure out the math and how that works. So that's why I have him a little bit below 10. And I thought about going 10, but the guy that I subbed out, because I had him 10 initially, the guy who I subbed out that's now number 10, we'll figure that out and why I have him at number 10. And there's going to be a guy, and I'm going to mention that guy. Is that going to be like, you have him in your top 10 too, by the way. So you understand, and you'll co-sign that I have him higher than this guy.
Yeah, so I'll just respond to that. And you make a lot of good points about the off-the-field stuff, like leadership and calling teammates out and all that stuff. And that's fair. But do you think Aaron Rodgers is cooked? Like, do you think he's washed? Like, do you think the Jets are going to – we're going to look back on this decision by the Jets and be like, they're really going to regret it? Like, it's going to blow up in their face like almost the Broncos did with Russell Wilson? Because I would say I'm not calling Aaron Rodgers to the Jets the exact same thing as Brady to the Bucks or Stafford to the Rams. But what I will say is it's closer to those than it is to Russell Wilson going to Denver.
It's like a seesaw, how I feel. I still think he can make the throws. Like, I don't think he's Peyton Manning's shot or Russell Wilson's shot. I still think he could stand in that pocket and rip that football. I think he has that. But I am taking consideration when you do get to the age of 39, injuries happen more. Like, I've seen it so many times. Phillip Rivers got injured more. Drew Brees got injured more. Tom Brady was the outlier there, right? Peyton Manning, neck injury happened, right? Like, I see injuries happen, so I do think we are injury away from seeing that decline, right? So it's kind of like that, like kind of like what I figured with LeBron James. You know, when he looked like Iron Man in the NBA, and now we see the accumulation, because he looked like Iron Man. Like, this guy can never get hurt. We've seen so many times, it like he tore his ACL. He's back at practice the same day, right? After the game is over, jacking them shots. So at a certain point, he started accumulating a lot of injuries. You know, I'm taking consideration the age. And sometimes people do look at your age, and it's natural. Like, some people look at your talent and think you're better because you're talented. And some people look at your age. Some people look at your height. You can't play because you're this tall. Like, some of those physical things and the perception matters. And my perception of age in a young man, but grown men sport, because it's a grown man sport, but it's a young man sport, that is the National Football League. I think Rodgers' prime is gone. And I understand a couple years ago was the back-to-back MVPs. But if we know how football works, a year difference, especially when you talk about 39, is a big difference.
In his career, threw one touchdown to a guy who was a first-round pick his whole career in Green Bay. And that was Mercedes Lewis a few years ago. And, you know, Mercedes Lewis is a wash tight end. That's their third string. Like, I want to see Aaron Rodgers play with Garrett Wilson. I don't know what the ceiling is or how it's going to end up with Garrett Wilson.
It's funny best because
Rodgers, I mean, Adams, but you know, Wilson is going to be probably the best, you know, just out of the draft. We don't know how good Wilson is yet. He, from a draft aspect, he's the best receiver Rodgers has ever played with. I want to see what he looks like with that dude.
And it's funny because a lot of people throw that terminology. You know, the Packers are very cheap. They haven't got him, that guy, right? That wide receiver. But basically, Garrett Wilson is Devontae Adams, right? No matter if one was drafted first round or second round, whatever, it's a clone. It's the same thing, right? So that's the number one wide receiver there. That cancels each other out. But then the guys that people complained about the Packers drafting, Alan Lazard, Randall Cobb, he bought with them over there. So, it's basically no difference when you think about it from that perspective. Garrett Wilson is Devontae Adams, the clone, and Alan Lazard and Randall Cobb, the guys that people hated. Oh, he needs more than that. He brought with him over there. It's the same thing. It's the Green Bay Jets. No difference. You just sprinkle the defense, but the Packers never had a bad defense, right? Sometimes it wasn't living up to the expectation. They had the number one corner, Jaire Alexander, but it wasn't a terrible defense. The Jets are better players.
Did they ever have a defense that's as good as this Jets defense, though?
No.
Like five elite
no.
defense?
the Jets defense is great, but this division is going to be tough. It is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Any other responses, Zach?
Yeah. Yeah. I will say so. I'll hit on a few quickly. So Kirk Cousins with the Vikings, and we didn't have the chance to talk about this, but I'm fascinated by the Vikings because they're down the path of, like, the term they use is a competitive rebuild. So, like, they want to rebuild, but they still want to be competitive while doing it. And I was just so fascinated by when they cut Dalvin Cook, right? That's really when it hit me. Like, man, I didn't realize how much talent the Vikings lost from a team that won 13 games and the NFC North last year. And I'm not just talking about Dalvin Cook. Like, I'm talking about Eric Kendricks on the defensive end. I'm talking about Danielle Hunter, who they likely are going to be moving on from. They traded Za'Darius Smith to Cleveland. They lost a lot of big-time contributors from that team from last year, and that's a team that won 13 games. And Rodgers just left the NFC North. So, like, it is such an interesting philosophy by the Vikings to be in on this competitive rebuild, and a lot of their top dogs go when we know the NFC is not – very good, at least compared to the NFC. It's a pretty wide-open conference behind Philadelphia. This Viking team won 13 games last year. They won the division, and their GM in his second year and they had a first-year coach when they won the division too in O'Connell. Like, he's saying, like, we're letting all these guys go, and we're going to have a competitive rebuild. And that is also goes back to what I said about Fields and the Bears in my take. Like, that makes me feel even better when looking at the Bears and their chances to win the NFC North this year. So what do you think of the Vikings offseason, and how do you see Kirk and their season going in 2023?
Yeah, I think it is a competitive rebuild. I think when you look at the microscope,
like, is that a real term, competitive rebuild? Like, is that something you could actually execute, or is it just something you say to make your fans happy?
It depends on what the expectation is. You know, I think, no, if you look at the terminology of the word, rebuild means you're subtracting to generate the process of trying to build back something later on. So it's like basically tanking in a way. Like, if I could find a word, rebuilding is basically tanking, right? It's just a more uniform word. Everybody hates the word tanking, but rebuild is tanking basically, but more, you know, a more like acceptable word among the masses, right? So when you're taking the word competitive means we're competing for something. Competitive rebuild, it doesn't make sense. However, when you look at the conference, because another team that I will put in that competitive rebuild stage in bracket, Buccaneers in the NFC South, when you look at those two divisions, the North and the South, like, the South is obviously worse, but the North is wide open because the quarterback that left, who we just talked about, Aaron Rodgers, who had a stranglehold over the division, is gone. Now it's everybody's bacon to grab, and we're having a game of, you know, get the bacon. And the Lions, they don't have a great defense. A lot of people sipping the Kool-Aid, but they never made the playoffs in mad long. So they are in the bracket of rebuilding, not rebuilding, but retooling. Like, I don't consider them to be basically retooling. They subtracted and added. Like, the moves they made was addition by subtraction or subtraction by addition. So you have to look at them like that. When you look at the Packers, they all be building around Jordan Love. Like, they're not competing, but they might compete if Jordan Love is that next guy. But we don't believe him to be, so they rebuilding. So when you look at everything, the Vikings have no choice but to do a competitive rebuild, even though that's not going to accumulate to anything long term. It's only going to make them worse as far as the moves that they can make in the future. I think Kirk Cousins is going to...
philosophy, though, after they won 13 games last year in a wide-open division and a wide-open conference.
You know, stuff, because it's like, how could you tank fully in a division where it's going to be hard to tank? I always take that in consideration. You know, listen, Kirk Cousins is going to leave after this year. So if I'm them, I would try to trade for Trey Lance, but that's another can of worms. I think if we specifically talking about Kirk Cousins, I still think on a competitive rebuilding roster, he can throw for 4,000 yards easy. You know, I like KJ Osborne to be that number two. I like TJ Hockenson to be the go-to guy outside of Justin Jefferson. They still got weapons here. So the competitive rebuild has nothing to do with where I think Kirk Cousins is going to be as far as my quarterback list is concerned. It has nothing to do with anything.
Yeah, and they drafted Jordan Addison out of USC too.
Yeah, they did.
A good player.
Yeah, so, you know, I don't really – even though they subtracted, like, I think they got better. Like, I do. Like, I think they got better, you know? Adam Dillon was shot, respectfully. I don't think he has that juice. He couldn't even separate like that a couple years ago. And last year, he was shot. Like, he'll make an occasional big play, but that's it. So now you making KJ Osborne, you moving him up the depth chart to be the number two. I like KJ Osborne better than Dillon at this part of his career. So they got better by that. TJ Hockenson, more familiarity with the system. They got better by that. You know, Jordan Addison, who we talked about, who we like, they added more weapons. They got better by that. The only difference is the running back position, where they subtracted Dalvin Cook off the roster, and now they are trying to get Madison to, you know, take those reps. That's the only difference. I think they got better. Brian Flores, addition, the defense, anything should be better than that defense last year. So when you really think about it, the Vikings did get better. I have all the proof to say why they did.
It's interesting to see, because their defense lost a lot, but they brought in Flores and the NFC North. I think this division is really intriguing to me, because a lot of people, as you said, are on the Lions hype train, and I could see why, especially after the way they ended last season. But for a franchise that hasn't had a ton of success, that is getting so much hype, I usually like to stay careful. The Vikings, they lost a lot. The Packers obviously got worse, and that just leaves Justin Fields and the Bears, who we both think is the best quarterback in the NFC North right now. So I'm intrigued.
Please like and subscribe for all the up-to-date content. You've been slinging shows left and right, slinging content left and right. Please don't miss anything. If you do, like, subscribe, leave a comment, or leave a question, something you may want to answer, something you may have. All ideas are great ideas. Nothing's a dumb question.